Who are you? Everyone's thinking, never seen him on the telly before, aren't you? Yeah. And people say to me, what have we seen you on? And I don't know, because we can't actually see what you're watching from inside the television. But I do a lot of stuff for BBC News. I just want to ask you a quick question. How much would you pay to get your product on for 2 minutes on BBC News, Sky News, Fox News and CNN? Would you pay £7,000 to get all of those? Hands up if you'd pay £7,000 for that. Okay? Hands up if you'd pay £700 for a 2 minute slot on those four networks. Okay? No, £700. Hands up if you'd pay £70. Everyone would pay £70, wouldn't they, to get your product on the telly? Okay, store that away. I was working for BBC News one day when I got a call to go to Long Clawson in Leicestershire to the dairy where they make Stilton cheese. Now, Stilton's only allowed to be made in Leicestershire, Derbyshire and Nottinghamshire at seven different dairies. And there was a story in the Melton Times, in Melton Mowbray, that the face of Elvis Presley had been found on a piece of Stilton cheese. Anyone remember that story? That was my job for the day. I was sent by the BBC to cover that story. And so I rang them up and said, OK, I'm coming up. And they went, right, there is a problem. The woman who discovered the piece of cheese is on holiday. And also, we have cut up the piece of cheese. So it wasn't a very good start. So I told my boss and I said, well, I won't bother to go then. And he went, no, I've seen the pictures in the Melton Times. It's brilliant. It really looks like Elvis on this piece of cheese. And as you know, of course, Elvis is the king. And I don't know how much you know about cheese, but in the cheese world, Stilton is known as the king of cheeses. So it was a massive, massive story. And it was my responsibility to go and do it. And so when I said to the editor, well, they've cut the piece of cheese up, there's no point going now. He said, no, Jeremy, you're going. You are going to cover that story. Because I have a little bit of a reputation in the BBC. When there's a story that you can't quite do, I will somehow make it happen. And he basically said to me, go and polish a turd. Get that story for me. And, sorry, is that all right, Jenny, that word? Oh, okay. But I couldn't really polish it, but I rolled it in glitter to make it a better story. And when I got there, the only way I could make the story work was to get an Elvis Presley impersonator to come with me, which I found on Radio Derby. It's a guy called Elvis Plesley, because Plesley is a village in Derbyshire. And he was a great big bloke. He mainly did the sort of Vegas end of the Elvis years. And the only way I could make the story work was to put in lots of puns about Jailhouse Rockfort and don't step on my blue vein cheese. And I just want to be your camembert. But my message to you tonight is, if you do get anything in your firm that is newsworthy, don't cut it up. You've seen the book, Who Moved My Cheese? I'm going to write a book, Who Cut Up the Cheese? So do try and get on telly with your interesting stories. And maybe it'll be me that turns up. I did David Beckham's face on a melon. That was one of mine. The man who fires chicken poo at a catapult to deter burglars. That was one of mine. I tend not to get the top stories. I don't know what it is. Once I did do a story on terror at the airport, some people rang in and said, was it a joke? Because Jeremy was doing it. And it wasn't. It was actually at Robin Hood Airport in Doncaster. So just think, for the sake of 70 quid on that bit of cheese, they could have had Sky, they could have had CNN, but they didn't go. They just had me in a funny hairnet doing some ridiculous Elvis songs. So think about your brand. My brand, obviously, is I'm Jeremy Nicholas. That's my name. And I used to present the breakfast show on GLR, BBC London. Did anyone used to listen to that? It was a lovely old radio station. It's BBC London, but it's GLR in the days when I presented breakfast. And one day, I was very tired at the end of the programme. I'd been presenting for a couple of years. Not the whole show in a couple of years, but for 2 years I've been doing it. And you get a bit jet-lagged when you do breakfast. And reception buzzed through and said, Jeremy, I've got Jeremy Nicholas in reception to see you. Which was a bit strange, but I was a bit tired, and I walked along the corridor, and I thought, suppose I get there, and it's me. Because you get a bit muddled when you do breakfast. And so I peered through the little round windows into the reception, and there was an old man with white hair. And I thought, well, that's not me. And then I thought, maybe it's me from the future. And I've come back, like in some sci-fi film, to warn myself about something, like in Terminator. But then I noticed I also had quite a lot of white hair, and you probably haven't noticed, I have a very small bald patch. But and this man didn't have one, and he was a bit taller than me as well, and I thought you're unlikely to carry on growing when you're in your 40s. So it wasn't me. And I went and had a chat with this bloke, and he said, "Hello, I'm Jeremy Nicholas. Have you heard of me?" And I said, "Well, the name sounds familiar." And we went for a drink, and after about half an hour, he was a terribly posh bloke, and he said, "Anyway, the thing about it is, I'm terribly worried about you having my name, and I'm going to have to ask you to change it. Because I'm an actor, and I have the equity card, and I've been using the name professionally since 1968. And I said, "Well, I was born with it in 1962. Anyway, Equity wrote to the NUJ, and there was a lot of to-ing and fro-ing, and this guy read Book at Bedtime on Radio 4, and Radio 4 said I had to change my name, and I refused. And so I stayed as Jeremy Nicholas. And then 2 years later, I got a really angry letter from him because he'd gone to a casting, and they said, "We haven't cast you for anything for years, Jeremy, because we keep seeing in Radio Times you do breakfast on GLR." So he wasn't very happy about that at all. And then another time, on Talk Radio, I used to present the business lunchtime programme on Talk Radio, and we had this guy come in about how to set up domain names, and he said, "I'll tell you what, Jeremy, I just checked before I came on, jeremynicholas.com is available, and do you know, by the end of the programme, the other chap had registered it." And that's why, to this day, I'm jeremynicholas.co.uk, not .com. And I was on LBC the other day, and they introduced me, and they read through all these things that I'd done. I went, "Yeah, no, that's not me. That's the other one." And can you believe it? When I came here tonight, the introduction that would have been read by Paul, if I hadn't spotted it, was about the other guy. But fortunately, I intercepted it. Anyway, he would have been much, much, much better. It's a fantastic introduction that he's got down here. I'll tell you who he is. Did anyone watch Birds of a Feather? He was the doctor on Birds of a Feather. They weren't ill very often. You won't remember him. It's a very, very bitter man. Check out his website. Just leave some posting saying, can you come and host this thing? And then when he replies, just say, "Oh, sorry, we thought you were the other one." Really, really will annoy him. So you did mention I'm the stadium announcer at West Ham. I did a gig last week. It was a very tough gig. I spoke at our end-of-season gala dinner the day after we were relegated. That was a tough kid. Did you read about it? I think there was a small little bit in some of the papers, you might have noticed. There was a very slight brawl that burst out, but at least we didn't go down without a fight, so that's all good. The hardest gig I did was Johannesburg earlier this year, when I was at the side of the stage, and I was doing this talk on how to use humour in your presentations, and I was just plugging my laptop in, and as I bent down to plug it in, my trousers all split at the back. About 6 inches on trousers. And I could hear the compere on the stage. And this was at the Emperor's Palace in Johannesburg. It was a global speaker summit, so they're all professional speakers. And he went, "And now the only speaker today on the from Europe here today is to talk on humour, Jeremy Nicholas." My wife's South African, so I can do the accent brilliantly. Actually, that sounds very much like her. She has a very deep voice. So I bent down. Trousers split. And I came on and I thought, I don't know what to do here. So I just came on like a space invader. Like this, going, "Oh, yeah, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. The worst thing that can happen when you're giving a talk on humour is that your trousers can split at the back," and everyone laughed. And then I said, "And that's just happened," and they all laughed again. And I thought, I'll just have to show them. So I turned around, and it was a terribly, terribly big split. And even at the end, people coming up to me saying, "We thought that was part of the act," as though I would pack a pair of trousers like that to fly to Johannesburg just to get one ridiculous laugh. I didn't. And at that gala dinner, funnily enough, last week, the guy I sat next to was the tailor who made me those trousers, because he's West Ham's official tailor. And so I told him the story, and he said, "Bring them in, I'll mend them." But sadly, I'd given them to the maid in my hotel to take home for her husband, because I thought, you know, it'd be a nice gesture. But I wish I hadn't done that now, because he could have mended them, he said. So, charity, what can you do with it? Okay, I've got the golden envelopes here. I feel a bit like Willy Wonka. Wouldn't it be awful if I drop these now and they're all in the wrong order? It'd be shocking, wasn't it? So anyway, well done everyone for getting here tonight with the rain and everything. Well done for getting here tonight with the rain and everything. And I actually did get hit by a frozen fish finger and some gatto. It was the fallout from Iceland. What hit me there? Right, let's get on to the awards, the golden envelopes. Here we go. Bit of energy in the room. Ladies and gentlemen, BESMA is a vital step on the professional and personal development ladder for all our entrants. It'll push the standards of professionalism for future generations, and we'd now like to celebrate in the success of those people who've reached the highest standards in the past year. And our first award this evening is for Sales Director of the Year.